You can move the table a little bit, and then you have it.
Sorry, Hahn. Better? Yeah. Okay.
I am Andrew M. Sato, Chief Instructor for the Aikido World Alliance. I'm a bad interviewer.
So. No,
this is great.
Well, at the end of 2004, beginning of 2005, I was kind of floating, let's say. Things had gone south with my relationship. And initially my idea was to just go practice at another dojo and be anonymous. I was so tired of politics. And then people contacted me and kept saying, let's start a dojo. So we started looking around and worked out of a community center for about 3 months. And I felt if I was going to do this, we should have a permanent space. The thought of lifting mats 2-3 times a week was getting really old fast. And so Laura DeGraff and I spent the whole day driving around and getting really discouraged. And she saw this place and said, we'll check it out. So we did. And the landlord turned out to be very amiable to us, and it's been a really good relationship. So we settled here. That was in March of 2005. I think our first class was the first week or two in April. The mats came, and we started from there. The landlord had a tool and die repair shop 2 or 3 doors down, and this was his other location, and he had. He used to be sell hardware things, but mostly he was selling barbecue grills. But then the big box store started to just really hamper him. So when we moved in, half the space for the mats was filled with Weber grills. So that's why the deck over there looks like a deck. He had a rail too. It looked just like a backyard deck, and he displayed it. So it was very nice. Every teacher I've ever experienced or studied under have always stressed the basics, and it's the building blocks, as you say. If you don't have good kihon waza, nothing else works. You can have a lot of fancy techniques or intricate movements, but they're all based on some very simple movements and some kihon waza. So I think in the last 2 or 3 years I've really started to focus moving a lot of my class that I teach off of ikkyo first. Maybe notice this weekend I've been doing that. So I don't know, just at some point I wanted to make it my art, my own art, and do different techniques or do it different ways, but I'm realizing why all those great teachers said kihon is important. So, Toyota Sensei was my first teacher, really my only teacher in a lot of ways. Because he gave me the basics and the impetus to really try to do Aikido long term. But I think Kobashi Sensei, Yasuo Kobashi, was influencing me because of his teaching style. He took Ukemi for all the students, and that was really the first teacher I ever saw that would demonstrate and take Ukemi. So I was really thrilled with that. And his teaching style of using weapons over a long training period, not just an hour. So those two things, and I hated weapons prior to that, so I'd say he's a pretty good influence on me. Yamada Sensei has been a great mentor to me, not I think so much for Aikido techniques, but understanding Aikido at a different level and as a teacher. And Yokota Sensei.
You said that you didn't like weapons at first when you were first training.
Hated them.
Yeah. First training.
Why?
I had long conversations with Toyota Sensei about this. And he goes, weapons are very important. I said, well, yeah, but I'm not going to be walking down the street with a Joe. I'm not going to tell somebody who attacks me, wait, let me go back and get my Boken. And he would get really upset with me. But I just never really liked it. But as I became a teacher and the chief instructor of an organization, I needed to really know those, otherwise how could we pass those on? And I've come to love them. Maybe as I'm getting older too, I just don't want to take many falls. So, but I feel it's a really good tool to help people learn their Aikido, their Maai, Especially on seminar times, they get tired, so you still have to focus and concentrate, but you don't have to take as many falls. And that's the thing I caught from Kobashi Shihan. I like them all. The Joe's the most creative, but I do like Boken. I say the Joe offers the most opportunities to teach, whereas the Boken is very limited. You only hold it a certain way. Yeah, so. Although I like Tantos, so I like all the weapons.
So when you started off with weapons and you realized that you like them, which one were you drawn to first?
Actually, the Boken, because I knew the katas that, well, I knew those the best at the beginning. And then since Toyota Sensei was no longer here, I need to expand that. So I watched some videos and I try to recall things. I went and trained with other teachers. So that gave me the opportunity to expand, yeah. But, again, I'd have to say Kobashi Shihan, yeah. And another teacher, we're friends. We grew up together. He was, you know, he runs a Yoshinkan organization. His name is Kevin Block, out of Ontario, Canada. He helped a lot too in terms of encouraging me with weapons. Yeah, I'd say those two. Weapons has its place, but they help you teach my concentration, because if you don't, or your movement is sloppy, you get hit. It's pretty simple. I think the one who really helped solidify that relationship between weapons, your question of weapons and training, is Yokota Sensei. He's very versed in the Aikido, and he clearly shows how the sword works with the technique. So he's really been a good example for me. Yeah. I can only speak for my dojo. The organization has grown. We're not huge, but we have grown. And that's attributed to the dedication, I think, and the efforts of the dojo chos. Each dojo is an independent dojo that is affiliated with AWA. So how their curriculum works, how they advertise, how they teach. You know, I can offer teaching techniques or some nuances, but it's really up to the dojo cho and his instructors or her instructors how to attract the students. So in that sense, we really have to look at the independent dojo cho and their students for attracting. Shamefully, Kiku Matsu does very little advertising. If anything, we've blocked off the windows so people can't even see. So
it makes it so exclusive, though.
Yeah, it makes it more mysterious.
To some degree, but we used to have it where you could see, and people would stand and watch, and we'd go like this, and they'd just walk away. So we said, okay, fine. And in this day and age, social media is such the avenue for getting any kind of information out, right? I hate to use the word advertising, but exposure. And no one here really has that kind of expertise. And I think I'm pretty lazy in that sense. It's like a dojo cho wants to start a club or a dojo. It doesn't necessarily mean they're a good teacher. It doesn't necessarily mean they're a good business person, because it is a business. So we learn, right, as we go along. And it's tough. But as far as advertising, I have to plead innocence or ignorance, one of the two. Yeah, some people come and seek out Aikido specifically. Others have just stumbled into it. They weren't looking for it, but they found they liked the atmosphere of the community. A lot of people don't necessarily start martial arts or Aikido in general because of the physicality of it, but the philosophy or the community they're in. So there's a lot of reasons people stay at a dojo. And so we have not figured out the formula to advertise, I guess, or expose ourselves to bring people in. It's been tough. But again, I think it's up to the dojo cho, and they do a great job. Unfortunately, Kiku Matsu is kind of weak in that area. But they learned something about what they've been practicing at their home dojo, that it made sense, that what they found here reinforced their belief of why they're doing Aikido. That their sensei and myself and the technical members, it reinforces what we're doing here is the same as they're doing there. And so my effort is to support the Dojo Cho, so they understand what they're teaching, and then their students believe in them because they say there's the connection. This is a living art. If we don't pass it on correctly, it becomes something really twisted. And I think that's a big conversation piece right now. It's not the same as Osensei's art or Nidai Doshu's art, but it is and it isn't. I mean, things change. My Aikido should look different from somebody else's, but it should look the same. And that's what I think they want to see, is some sense of continuity. That, why did I spend this money and all this effort to come here? Just to see a bunch of sweaty people? No. Because they build and reinforce that intentional community. Right? So that yes, what I'm doing is validated, that this is really a worthwhile endeavor. You know, you can learn some of these things just watching YouTube, but it's that experiential thing of meeting people, practicing together, testing out is it valid or not. I think those are things people come away from seminars with. So, like I said, Toyota Sensei was my teacher, and I'll forever be in debt to him. And I don't think I could ever reach his quality. I don't. I guess everybody needs something to always strive for. But in the same breath, I think I've come into my own to some degree. But to say that I've mastered it, no. No way. It's an ongoing process. So I'm always learning about, why did I change this? Why do I start doing this? Because I realized something, right? So I'm always open. They always talk about the beginner's mind. So I feel I've been really lucky that way. That I just wake up every morning wanting to learn more. So I think it's important. Otherwise you stop, you get really bored. You get bored and you won't be able to really see what somebody's trying to teach. Yeah?
Yeah.
You see Shomen Uchikyo every day, but something changes. Why did it change? Because all of a sudden you see something, and that's what I think excites me. We want to keep finding things out. So. Yeah. And also because I'm the chief instructor, I need to stay ahead. Tanoe Roshi was another teacher. He wasn't a teacher of Aikido, but he was a Zen master. And he would always say, you sit 30 minutes, I'll sit an hour. You sit an hour, I'll sit 2 hours. And I've really bought into that. So, excuse me.
So what connection did the gear head and the
okay.
head?
I would say from the time I was a child, and this is probably Asian oriented to some degrees, you don't want to be a ditch digger all your life. That's what my parents would always say. You have to get educated. Education was really big with them. And I will say as a young person, I was not too keen on education. But I have realized, and at an early age, that I have a very addictive personality. So if I like something, I just, as you say, go tunnel vision. And I like the physicality of sports, the competition of it. I wasn't very good. But I found something I really liked in Aikido. And I will say the reason I like, well, part of the reason I became so enamored with the Grateful Dead, there's a lot of similarity in my mind of the Grateful Dead and Aikido. Their sense of adventure, to keep learning, to keep discovering, they make mistakes, so what? They just keep on going. They don't have a set formula. Like a lot of bands, you can go to a show on Monday in Albuquerque and then Santa Fe on Tuesday, and it'll be the same show. Word for word, note for note, time for time. Right. That's you can listen to a record doing that. So the Grateful Dead was an experiential thing. And then there was they encouraged involvement between the audience and community and the band tremendously. They allowed taping. Most bands don't like that. So they allowed that. That kind of stuff. I think it's the same thing here in Aikido. It's the experience and the community that you develop together. And so the more you know, the more you don't know, kind of thing, right? So it's that sense of adventure that really has kept me going with Aikido. And now as a teacher, seeing that in students, that aha moment, right? Or I got it, I see what you've been trying to tell me. And that's really rewarding. Not that that's what I'm looking for, but it validates that my teaching's acceptable, that there's a quality to it, and that students are also getting what I got at their stage. I see them where they are as a yellow belt or a blue belt or even a shodan, right? I see where I was back then. I remember. I don't forget that. I see that. And so that whole thing of really feeling it's the right thing to do. Because so many times you're not given approval by your parents or by your teacher or by your boss. And so it's different, you know. Well, I hope that answered that question.
It did, but I'm going to go back to the gearhead part because I appreciate you giving me a ride to wherever. I would qualify you close to being an aggressive driver.
My wife would say I am.
What makes you drive the way you drive, and what makes you so, you're into cars, you're into performance vehicles?
Yes.
Yeah, why?
It's the rush. It's the rush I get here on the mat. You know, I've been practicing for a long time. I can't even remember how many years, but I get so excited when I come to the dojo. I get the anticipation of getting on the mat practicing, you know? So that same feeling I have is going to a dead show or getting in my car, that I'm like a kid again. And I think that's important to anybody. You don't want it to become dull or just routine. So okay, gotta go to work.
For sure.
You know, I was blessed with two careers. This is my Aikido career. Prior to that, I worked in private industry, but I can count probably on both hands the days I hated to get up and go to work. I enjoyed getting up and going because I liked what I was doing. It was engaging. I grew from it. If you don't have that in your life, whatever you do is not going to have that same quality. That's for sure. That's a pretty hard question. I really don't have an answer. I don't know. A good example is I took 12 years of guitar, and I used to play on a basketball team. As soon as I discovered Aikido, I mean, literally like turning off a light switch, I just lost interest. And I didn't realize how powerful that moment was until I look back and talk about it. Because my kids used to talk about sports, and I go, because I just wasn't interested. And so certain things just changed my life. And you don't even realize those moments until you look back. So I don't know, if I didn't have Aikido, I don't know what I would be doing. I definitely wouldn't be a mechanic. I just like driving cars.
This is a good amount of time. We got a lot.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sensei.
Thank you, Sensei.
Thank you for your efforts.
Thank you so much. Are you going? All right.
Thank you. Appreciate
it. Let us get out of your way.
It's okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sensei.
It was an old process called dive transfer. But his love was taking pictures himself. I'd just go around with him and carry his shit. But I was into photography too. But then I'd bring him back and say, well, what about this, Dad? He goes, well, you could have done this. I said, I got tired of that shit. Stop taking pictures. I was telling Jeremy, when we were kids, we'd have to do the holiday photo, all the siblings.
Yeah.
They'd dress us all the same way. My dad would have this big camera and slide out the negative and slide it back in. I'm just giving you a hard time.
Oh. What do you want to talk about? The Cubs?
Chicago Bears. Oh yeah, we were talking in the hallway with Hahn, and she was like inching away. I didn't ask him if he liked the griffin. Oh, he scammed me.
Country music.